nice, but some of them think that we're like teenagers and like, you know, always messing around.
I think that they think we are spoiled. We get away with all sorts. Like at school, we just get a DT where they used to get hit with a ruler.
I think poor people think poor people are sometimes spoiled and not very well mannered compared to how they were as children.
Cindy doll. They used to have Barbie dolls, but I think the first one was a Cindy doll. The same idea, teenage doll.
Oh, I think I had a doll. Yes, a doll.
Dinky toys. Little cars and wagons and toys like that. I used to play a lot with those.
We'd once brought a doll, a pop doll, which broke its limbs every time I dropped it. And had to go to the doll's hospital. But I didn't want a doll, I wanted a teddy, and I never got one.
A doll and a pram.
A little doll my auntie bought me, that used to open its eyes and shut them when you stood it up and laid it down.
There was 11 children, and mum and dad. We lived in a two up, two down, with flag floors and the big black range that had to be cleaned two or three times a week. That range was used for cooking as well as the kettle being on it. Also, it had various cubbyholes where Mum placed the dough in to make bread. Mum made bread every day for us. And there was always that smell of yeast and bread rising in the house. It was a bit cramped, but we were happy in our own way. And we were no different than our neighbours. Lots of people lived in cramped conditions in them days.
There was six of us in the family, my two brothers, which were 10 and 11 year older than me. So they were working by the time I was growing up, really. And my sister, who is 5 years older than me, and then my mum and dad. My dad were a miner, and my mother worked at mill.
I had 9 brothers and a sister, but I can only remember 5 brothers. 4 must have died before I were born.
There was already 11 children when I was born. There was 15 altogether. There was 15 children, but there were 4 babies. They died when they were young. So I was brought up with, say, 11 of us. And it was only a 2-bedroom and 2 rooms downstairs. But we managed. It was hard work for our parents, but 3 in a bed. I think the babies used to sleep with our parents, etc. But we got there okay. And then in 1938, I was 11, 12, we got a 3-bedroom house in Hampton Street. A bath, electric lights, which we'd never had, and a big cellar, massive back garden, and a little garden up front. And there was iron railings round when we first went in, but of course, they all came down because of the war. So that 3-bedroom house, it was like a mansion to us. It was brilliant.
My mother died before I was 3, so I went to Wellingborough to live with my grandma. So there was just my grandma and me.
We weren't allowed to play outside through the garden gate. You couldn't go on the street because we fortunately had a Canon Slade School at the garden. You weren't allowed that. If we misbehaved, we had to stay in for a fortnight and that killed us. We've had the strap off my dad more than once. And I didn't really have a happy childhood in a way. I loved them and I was supposed to love me. But being the eldest, I was supposed to show example, you see, to the others.
In a lot of things, we were sheltered. We definitely weren't streetwise. We played on our doorsteps or in the back street. We never wandered far from home. We weren't allowed to.
And we used to play running around the garages and play football on the back street, throwing stones at one another, which you weren't supposed to do.
And toys, we made our own. We played hopscotch. I remember my dad coming home from the mill with a pair of skipping ropes, which we got over there. Toys were very few and far between. We played round it. And in the of an evening when mums and dads were sat outside, we'd play round it. And all the street would join in. So that were good fun. And the mums were there peeling spuds ready for the next day. Everything had to be done. Nothing were wasted, nothing were thrown away. Potato peelings were given to the lady across the road who had a small hole in with chickens and things. She made a mash-up of them with other things for the chickens and the pigs. And it was a bartering tool, really. Mum baked bread and swapped bread for eggs, for vegetables, for anything that were going. There wasn't a lot of meat, but there was some, and it spread, and she made it spread over a few days, you know.
Oh, my father, my dad, he was a carter, which he had a horse and cart. He'd go out delivering coal, and he used to work for Bolton Council. I remember one day going with him, and he had a tipper truck, and we went under what is now the market hall, go underneath there and collect cardboard and things like that, and I had to get under the sheet while he went down underneath, because we weren't supposed to be with him, and I had to hide underneath. I remember that very well.
We grew up, it was a row of terraced houses, and there weren't much traffic. We always played on streets. There was a field up at the top, and at the bottom there was a mill which had electric gates put on, and we used to go around about 6 o'clock when they were closing so that we could sit on them and ride around on the gate, because we'd never seen anything like that.
They were always busy. Mum mainly. Dad went out to work, but Mum stayed at home. She washed everything in a dolly tub. On a Monday morning, you couldn't get in the kitchen for dolly tubs, and they did everything by hand. And they used to hang the stuff out in the back street. I remember having to run outside with Mum and get the washing in while the coal wagon went past. Then we'd hang them up again. Monday was hectic. Mum had a day for everything. Tuesday was ironing, but in between she was baking all the time, bread, pies, whatever. And Mum never seemed to stop. It was one thing after another with 11 children, making sure people had clean clothes on before we went out. She was a very proud woman that way. When she hung her washing out, it hadn't to have a spot on it. And I remember, because we lived in a mill town, there was a lot of soot and dust. And we used to hang the washing out, and there'd be all this dust about, and she'd bring all the washing in and she'd start all over again. So she never stopped from morning till night. She was a very busy woman. And she looked after us the best way she could. There wasn't a lot of clothing, even after the war. But we wore hand-me-downs, if you know what that means. What my elder sister had no use for, I got. And so on to my youngest sister.
Very happy, and everybody looked after each other. Everybody knew everyone. We all knew which child belonged to which parent, and things like that.
It was a tough time looking back, but as kids we were happy. You know, we didn't have the weight of what mum and dad had on their shoulders, feeding 11 kids, keeping them clean. And also, the front doorstep had to be mopped every day. A good section of the pavement had to be done. And same with the backyard, although nobody ever saw it, only us, it still had to be done. And quite often, when mum was busy with the younger ones, we were the ones that did them jobs as girls, not the boys. The boys had a good time, you know, when you think about it. It was hard.
It was all right. There's no pressure, really, as much as there is today. So, you know, we just got on with things, and that were it.
Christmas, like, it was stocking hung up with an orange apple, money at bottom, and we'd get one present. But they were happy times, if you understand what I mean, because everybody was in the same boat. So we're all like competition.
We didn't play anywhere else but on the front or on the back. And basically that's it. From where, it was a very small world for me. That street was my world. I know there was a main road, Alloway Road, but I never were allowed to venture up there. That was out of bounds. So yeah, I lived in a very small world. That's why we grew up not streetwise at all.
The usual ones, maths, English, history, geography, music. The girls did cookery and sewing. The boys did carpentry and metalwork. But they'd only just started doing things like metalwork then. And of course we did PE and gym every week, games.
Well, I loved English and I loved history. And I weren't bad at maths.
Well, the usual English, arithmetic, that sort of thing. I could never get my head around algebra, no way, and logarithms. I admire youngsters today because they're so, so very advanced in what we were. But school, when I went to Whitecroft, we had cookery lessons. I could have taught the teacher cookery. You know, I knew how to bake. We did sewing lessons. I used to like them sort of things, rather than, I like geography and history, but the rest I weren't really keen on.
I think it's harder today, I must admit. I couldn't help my grandchildren with their homework or anything.
We either got detention at school when we did, and we did lines in detention, or we got the strap when we went to secondary school.
Well, if we were punished, we had to stand in the hall under a clock. So you stood there nearly all day before it. That was our punishment.
We used to get the, when we were at school, we used to get the ruler across our knuckles. The boys got the cane.
Usually like a cane or plimsoll.
If any of the lads did wrong, they had to go up on the stage every morning and bend over, and they had the cane while everybody watched. Girls got the slipper or a ruler, but the lads got a cane. Oof. Terrified me, absolutely terrified me.
You had to stop in at the play times. Wouldn't let you go out and play. Or if you were doing something in your class, you'd get a piece of chalk thrown at you, or the blackboard thrown at you, and if one of them hit you, you knew.
I was terrorised at school. I hated it. During lessons, quite often a board duster would come flying past your ear, or a piece of chalk, or you'd get slapped on the knuckles with a ruler. Especially if you were left-handed and you were using your left hand. I'm not left-handed. You'd even get a slap on your knuckles for just not being tidy with your writing. So, yeah, I didn't like school.
Well, if you did something wrong, you was either stood in the corridor or you got the cane. It just depended on what you'd done and how you'd done it and why you'd done it. It was very strict in my school.
Detention, or if you'd done something really serious, you used to get the cane.
There were three different sorts of punishment. If it weren't too bad, it was right on your fingertips. Painful. Then secondly, should say, stand in the corner, face to the wall. Right. Thirdly, go in the hall and write 100 times, I must not speak in class. I must not speak in class. That 100 times, you could miss your playtime or anything, but you had to do 100 lines before you could go back in the classroom. And if you went home and told your parents what you had to do, they'd ask you, why? And when you told them you'd been talking and etc., etc., they'd probably say, well, you know now, don't talk in class. That's your punishment.
Oh, well, you're kind of frightened because it's something that... Well, I went to the ward maid, so I had to walk in a ward full of patients, you know. It was really... You know, you're a bit frightened, wondering what's going on. And then I had to live in at Manchester, I didn't stay at home. So it was a bit strange at first. But I enjoyed it.
I left school at Christmas 1940. Started with Ben. Yeah. Happy days then. I went straight into the mill. Little piecing, side piecing, and then I finished up a mule spinner. And I'm living next to Samuel Crompton, who invented the mule spinning. And I loved it.
My first job was apprentice florist. And I was nervous, but it was a nice couple, Mr. and Mrs. Rainwide. And they were very, very good, very helpful. It was nice arranging flowers and things like that.
I went to work at 14. I got a scholarship to go to Manchester Art College, and my parents were dead against that. Girls didn't have careers. So I said, oh, well, I want to be a nurse. And no, you can't be a nurse. Well, what can I do? You're going in the mill. My dad took me to the mill where he worked. And I worked in the mill because there were other children to bring up. You turned your wages over every Friday. I think I got the grand sum of, equivalent today of £1.80. And Mum had the £1.50 and I had what was left. That was the first time I ever had spending money, really.
Well, once I left school at 14, then I went and I learnt shorthand and typing for 12 months. And then I got a job at Whitworth's Flour Mills, and I went there as a typist. I used to do the invoicing. And I also used to have to add up all the miles that the lorries had done because of petrol. You know, they were only allowed so much petrol. But it was an interesting job, I enjoyed it.
I was very nervous and frightened, and I felt a bit lost really. It was such a big change from school.
First day at work, well, very nervous going. We started at 7:30, finished at 5:00. I worked in the mill first, winding, but it was hard work. But it was frightening the first day you go, because everybody's all eyes on somebody new going. A bit nervous. I'm only tiny, you see, so I'm just kept because of a little. I didn't think I could do things.
That was the most terrifying world of to me, was all this machinery. You couldn't hear yourself speak. I did learn to lip read eventually, but And the thoughts again, your fingers stuck in this machinery. And it was fast, and you had to earn your wage. You couldn't walk slowly up and down. You were given two or three looms to look after, with the cotton coming down onto corns. And you had to be quick, and you had to knot it if it broke. And while you're doing that, all the rest of things are overflowing, and you were running up and down, a terrifying world.
Although I was only, I was growing up, and I knew there were a lot of people out to work, especially the cotton mills and the pits, a lot of people out to work. And it really took the war to get full employment.
But when war was declared, my dad made me come home because he was frightened of being, you know, being bombed. So I went working at we made detonators for the miners to blast the coal out of the... So I was on an exempt job. I wouldn't be called up.
When the war started, you had to have black lines at your window. Every window had to be blacked out when it was dark, when it was coming dark. Now, somebody's advised that. If there were any lights showing, when any of the planes were going over, they're going to be lit up the bombs. If they saw a light, you didn't know it. But we had men going around, AIP wardens. And if they saw a light shining from anywhere, they would shout, "Turn that bloody light out!"
I can remember the blackouts, and we had an iron pin down curtains so light wouldn't get in. And we could hear the planes going over. We had to go in the urban shelter then. It was cold in there, but my mum, took out water bottles then. Remember ration boots?
My dad, he had to go to, when Manchester were terribly bombed, at Liverpool, and he had to go there, helping out. And there was one instance, I didn't know this, but one of my sisters told me this, I never knew it, but we were too young then, we didn't know. And he went to the infirmary, wherever it were, with somebody's head. He just picked somebody's head up, you know, and took it to the infirmary, wherever it went. And I thought, he could do anything like that. My daddy, he never bothered, he could do anything, put it down to anything.
Well, we used to hear the planes going over to go out to bomb Germany and places like that. And we used to hear them coming across to us. And they used to go to the bigger cities. London got hit terribly. I was glad I was no longer living there. But we just got a few incendiary bombs in Wellingborough. That was all.
Every night, every Sunday night on the wireless, we called him Lord Haw-Haw. His real name was William Joyce. He was English, but he was a traitor. He went over to Germany and started on the wireless propaganda, telling us to pack in. We'd never have a chance of winning anything. But after every broadcast at Sunday, he gave three names of prisoners of war, and we listened to their names for nearly 12 months. And we never heard nothing from the War Office. And then one night, we'd gone to bed, we'd missed that one night. Knocked on the door about 12 o'clock. Mrs. Matthews, Lord Haw-Haw's just give you a Bill's name out. He's a prisoner of war. And then the morning after, when the post came, the official letter came from the War Office. It was a prisoner of war in Stalag 8B in eastern Poland. But we never saw it then. But odd times, we started getting letters. We used to send parcels, etc. And we started getting an odd letter, but they couldn't say nothing in them. They just had to say, we're doing all right, and see it, you know. They couldn't say anything proper, or the Germans would have censored it, they'd have just scrapped it. And when he came home, Now we were eight on here, and they were all my brothers, apart from me, were 6 foot two or three or four, big lads. And he was eight on the perfection. And when he came over the water, he stood there. So he must have gone through something that, you know, didn't do for him. He must have seen to that up, no. But he stuttered. So if he stuttered, they must have really did something wrong.
I can remember the planes used to go over where we lived to go to Liverpool to bomb the docks. But I can't say I remember anything. There may have not been a war on where I lived. It was a little village. They used to just go over and come back.
I know we lived in a war, that we were brought up in a war, yeah. And strangely enough, it brought the people together. More friendlier, more helpful with one another. And when you finished, when the war ended, you'd say, hey, weren't it all right? Meaning the people were better. Everybody had changed their attitude. They had to do, and they did.
Brilliant. Pop songs, dances, cinemas, boys. Loved every minute of it.
Well, I loved it. Same as you love being a teenager. I love being a teenager. I enjoyed myself.
I love sports. I'm in tennis team. I'm in cricket team. Never used to go and watch the girls play hockey and rounders and have a football fanatic. But a sport fanatic, really, yeah. And happy days.
It was okay when I was growing up. I used to go to the skating rink. I used to go to the pitches. We used to have a lot of friends. We used to go dancing. But the best part of my teenage life was ice skating. Not ice skating, roller skating. But we don't have anything like that now.
To be a teenager when I was one was, I couldn't do a lot. I used to go to the library twice a week with a friend of mine. And I can remember we always walked past this house where there was a lad that I used to like. We used to try and see if we could see him.
That was one of the things when we were younger. If we went to the pictures, we used to take jam jars, and they took the jam jars off you as you went in. So that paid for you going in watching the film. So when I had money after I'd worked, I could afford to go to the pictures properly, pay, and have a few coppers left over for some sweets or whatever, for a treat.
The majority of kids of today are good kids. They don't have enough discipline. Although I was spoilt, I still had plenty of discipline. I had to do as I was told, and they were, and definitely taught right from wrong. But the kids of today, like all kids, they think they're always right, but they don't listen and they don't use the head, the common sense they were born with. That's why they get in a lot of trouble.
They have no respect. You know, have you ever been on? I've been on the bus going to Smithel School, and if I'd have been the bus conductor, I would have stopped the bus and put the ball off and made them walk. And I said to one, I said, I'm going to see the headmaster. Oh, what can he do? He said. I could have hit him. I thought if any of my children did that when they were going to school, I'd have belted them.
The young people today, I think they're under a lot of pressure. A lot of pressure, more than we had when we were kids. Although I hated school, I do think education is the best way forward for everybody. I've watched my grandchildren growing up, and now I'm watching my great-grandchildren. And I don't honestly think I'd like to have been young now and having a family. I think it's very, very hard.
Well, the same as everybody else is thinking, but I mean, you're not all turned with the same brush. I won't have that, but respect. I don't think any of you know what respect is. I mean, maybe a few of you do, but the majority no. I mean, like Betty said, I had to, when we went on a bus, and if we didn't give our seats up for an elderly person, oh, we were shunned. It wasn't known. But, all right, you can be respectful if you wish, and some of you are very nice, but the majority, no, I wouldn't like to bring any child up today.
Well, I think, on the whole, the children today, I don't know, they get too much of their own way, and, they seem to do just what they want, when they want, but we weren't allowed to.
They do tend to get a lot of their own way. They won't listen to what you're told. They always think they're right.
Well, I think a lot of them have no respect for elderly people. I really do for anybody. No respect for the parents. They think they're getting after them, they're not. They're only giving them advice. We only listen, never mind smiling.
With loads and loads of corner shops. Sometimes with shops at middle of the street. You'd never had to go in town for anything. Even when you paid your rent or anything like that, they came for the money. But now you have to go, no pay. You have to go in town now shopping because there's no corner shops or anything.
There's been a lot of changes while I've been growing up. We didn't all have telephones like you have now. We didn't have fridge freezers. We didn't all have coloured tellies and cars.
The pictures, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, they showed the film. And Thursday, Friday, Saturday, it was a different film. At 10 o'clock, you all stood up and it was finished. And before you could come out of the cinema in them days, you had to sing God Save the Queen. Some of them had run out before the end, just so they didn't have to do it. But you always had to sing God Save the Queen. Well, you didn't have to sing it, but you had to stay there till it was played and finished, and then you could come out. That's another big difference today. They don't do that today, do they?
The way children have the freedom these days, we didn't. My mum was... Girls didn't have careers. Boys did, and we were at a choice to do when we came home from school, and there wasn't much time really for playing out. But and then as we got older, decimalisation came in, and that was a big thing. It took some getting used to after pounds, shillings and pence.
It's like there were no courier Indian restaurants or Chinese where I live, so it was like straightforward English cooking. Potato pie, roast dinner, bacon, eggs.
Oh, my mum made a lot of broths and stews, and we had porridge at morning and all that. And, you know, Sunday she'd make a great big steak pudding. She baked her own bread, did all her own cakes and everything, not like today. There were no fast food or anything like that. But it was good food.
Everything stopped at 10 o'clock. The pubs closed at 10 o'clock. Chip shops closed at 10 o'clock. The pictures finished at 10 o'clock.
Well, there's a lot of changes. I mean, you've got all these mobiles, you've got cameras, proper nice cameras, you've got, what are they called? iPods or whatever they are. And I mean, I can only just turn my video on. And I can't use I can't text on a mobile. So all that was in the past. We had nothing like that. Nothing at all. Now, whether it's gone for the best, I don't know. But anyway, that's how the world crumbles, isn't it?
I wouldn't get married as early as what I did if I had my life over again, and I'd make more of the opportunities. There wasn't the same opportunities as they are now, but I would have done more with my life, gone out more, seen more.
Well, nothing. I've lived my life and I've loved it and I wouldn't change anything.
I don't think I'd change anything, to be honest, because we didn't know any different. we just plodded on and carried on and hoped for the best. But no, I don't think I'd change anything.
I don't think I'd change anything. I've been quite happy with my life.
I don't think I'd change anything. No, I wouldn't like to say that, but I could change to be more happy than what I have been and content. Yeah. Laugh and sing, be happy, it's the thing. Be happy, wink your eye, then fix your tie. Be as I, be happy, fall in line. Be happy, waste no time. Be happy, time won't wait, why hesitate? Call it fate, be happy. When that guy called trouble throws you for a loss, heads or tails, win or lose, show him that you're still the boss. Start
at first day, I thought there was going to be happy, quite nasty and not talk to us, but then when we met Lynn last week, we was really happy that we met Lynn and we was talking to Lynn.
I think they're nice, but they think that we're a bit of a troublemaker. But if you get to know them more, they're actually quite nice.
We all think we're clever when we're growing up, and people tell us things, and we think we know it all. And we'll all keep making the same mistakes generations on.
You've only wants to live, so live it. Enjoy yourself. And if you're ambitious, if you want to get on, you get on. If you don't, you don't.